It's Antioch Live on your radio at WBGX 1570 AM and online at gospel1570.com, ambcchicago.org, YouTube, and Facebook Live. Featuring our lead pastor, the Reverend Dr. Gerald M. and our digital pastor, Reverend Terrell Carter.
Hello and welcome to Antioch Live. Thank you so much for tuning in, logging on, wherever you're listening or watching. It is a privilege to be able to worship the Lord along with you. Let's go to scripture. Romans 8 and 18 says, "For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us." Shall we pray? And I want you to go ahead and grab hands with someone you may be watching this broadcast with, or just let's connect together in prayer. We're praying for our nation with the decision that's going to happen on Tuesday. Either way, we're praying that God's peace will reign. We're praying for our neighborhoods, for the violence in our communities. We're praying for parents and children who are dealing with e-learning. We're praying for all of the issues and the ailments. We're praying for our sick and shut-in. We're praying for Deacon Vernon Huff. We're praying for Jacqueline Yancey. We're praying for Wilbur Daniel Jr., all of our sick, shut-in, bereaved families. Wherever you are, whatever you're facing, Antioch wants to connect with you in prayer. As a matter of fact, if you've got prayer requests, you can send them to our website. You can call the church. We want to connect with you in prayer. You ready? Let's pray right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, how we thank you, how we honor you, how we praise you for your faithfulness and your consistency in being our help and our strength. God, you know everything that we're facing. You know everything that we're going through. And God, we pray that you would get glory out of all things. God, we pray that you would get glory out of the election. God, we pray that you would get glory out of every trial that we face. You said in your word that we're able to cast our cares upon you because you care for us. And so, God, we're expecting the outpouring of your blessing. We're expecting your peace and your glory to reign. God, we're expecting that you would literally do the miraculous and change someone's life. We're even praying that you would bless someone through the broadcast on today. In the mighty and matchless name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Well, I can't believe it. It's another first Sunday. It's the first Sunday in November. So, of course, you know that means we're going to celebrate the Lord's Supper. And so I hope you get your elements ready. But it being the first Sunday in November also means that it's been 8 months since we've been worshiping and connecting in this way. We've had to do things differently under a pandemic. And so I want to say thank you to all of you all who have connected with us online, connected with us through our Zoom prayer calls, and those who connected and partnered through giving. Your financial contributions have helped Antioch to feed people during the pandemic. It has helped us to expand our ministry digitally. It has helped us to preach the gospel literally around the world. And so I want to say thank you on behalf of our entire church and our pastor. Thank you for partnering with us. And so I want to say thank you to you, and I want to encourage you that if you've not given, if you've not sown, you can do that right now. There are a few ways you can give here at Antioch. You can go to our website, ambcchicago.org, click on the giving tab, and you can give there. You can give through the Givelify app. Download that app from your app store and search for Antioch Missionary Baptist Church, and you can give there. You can mail or drop off your donations to our physical building, Antioch Missionary Baptist Church, 415 West Englewood, Chicago, Illinois, 60621. You can also call the church number at 773-873-4433, and you can make arrangements for your gift to be picked up. And you can give through Zelle using the email address antiochchurchchicago@gmail.com. The Bible lets us know that the Lord does bless a cheerful giver, and he's able to bless you even right now. And so go ahead and sow those seeds. For giving is an act of worship. And so we're able to worship through giving. We're going to worship in singing as Joyce Barnes leads us in praise and worship. And then we're going to worship through the word as we're taught the word by our lead pastor, the Reverend Dr. Gerald M. Go ahead and tag somebody's name in the comments. Share this broadcast right now. Antioch family and friends, let's go to worship.
How great is Good morning, and God bless you, and welcome again to another edition of Antioch Live. We're grateful to God for this first Sunday in November. Amen. And what an incredible day today is. It is the day the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. Listen, if you've not handled your civic duty in terms of going to the poll and voting, make sure you go on Tuesday, November the 3rd. Amen. And I pray to God that you just vote your convictions. And we know that God has the whole world in his hands. And so whoever wins, amen, it's okay because God is still on the throne. Amen, amen, amen. Thanks again to our digital pastor, Pastor Carter, to our music ministry and all that are involved in helping bring this service of worship to you. Amen. We just thank God for all that is happening and all that is going on here at the Antioch Church. Amen. I want to call our attention this morning to the Gospel of John, chapter number 11, John chapter 11, verses 1 through 4, verses 1 through 4. The text says, "Now a certain man was sick named Lazarus of Bethany, the town of Mary and his sister Martha. It was that Mary which anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. Therefore his sister sent unto him, saying, Lord, behold, he whom thou lovest is sick. When Jesus heard that, he said, This sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified thereby. Thus ends the reading of God's holy word." I want to talk today about a message to the master from Martha's house. A message to the master from Martha's house. Last Sunday, we traveled with Jesus to Bethany, where Martha welcomed him into her house. She accepted him, received him, welcomed him for the great purpose of serving him as an honored guest. In today's text, we find that trouble has come to Martha's house. And you know, trouble has a way of doing that. It can find your address. It can find your place of employment. It can find the college campus that you are taking classes on. It can find the classroom that you're in. Trouble has a way of finding our addresses and finding where we are, and trouble will come where we are. And in this story of Mary and Martha and Lazarus and Jesus, there are several key verses that I would really like to lift as we walk through this narrative of what happens when they send this message to the master from Martha's house. Listen first to what the message was. "Lord, look, the one that you love is sick." That was the message. The one that you love is sick. It was a message sent from Martha's house. It was sent by both her and Mary, and the message was sent to the master. And obviously, the degree of sickness or the degree of trouble that had come to the home, that it invaded the physical body of their brother Lazarus, was obviously more than what human instrumentality could handle. It was obviously more than what the physicians at that day and at that time could deal with. It was obviously more than what home remedies could handle. And so they sent this message to Jesus: the one that you love is sick. Listen, if you have trouble in your house, if trouble has come to your location and your address, I encourage you, send a message to the master. Pray to him, call to him, cry out to him, invite him to come see about you. And I guarantee you, he will respond. Listen, when Jesus heard that Lazarus was sick, he said, "This sickness is not unto death." And the word death that he uses here is this sickness is not going to result in Lazarus being eternally separated from God. This sickness is not unto death, but this trouble has come. This trouble has come for the glory of God, and so the Son of Man, or so that Jesus himself would be glorified. Listen, everything that happens in this story is for the glory of God and that Jesus would be glorified. Do you not know that God allows things to happen to us? And sometimes, and when I say God allows things to happen to us, I mean some of the negative things that occurs in our lives, some of the troubles that happen in our lives. God allows things to happen to us. But then on the other hand, God also causes things to happen for us. I mean, he'll open doors for us. He will shelter us from storms. He will bless us. He causes things to happen for us. But whether God allows something to happen to us or whether God causes something to happen for us, in either case, it is ultimately for his glory. Listen, I need you to understand that maybe what you're going through right now has more to do about God getting glory out of your situation and out of your life than it may have to even do with you. And so what Jesus does is he literally delays his departure. He stays where he is after receiving the news that Lazarus is sick. He stays an additional two days and delays his departure. And after 2 days, he turns to his disciples and he says, "Listen, let's go back into Judea." But remember, the last time he was in Judea, the scribes and the Pharisees and some of the religious leaders, they took up stones to stone him. And so going back to Judea meant going into harm's way, going into a place of danger. But that's what I love about Jesus. Even if it's dangerous for him to come see about us, he's willing to endure the danger just to come see about us. There are some family and friends that we have. If you're in a certain place, they're not trying to come. They're not trying to put themselves in harm's way to come and see about you. But Jesus was willing to go back to Judea, even when the disciples reminded him, "Master, do you really want to go back there? Remember the last time we were there, they took up stones to kill you." But Jesus reminds those disciples that, listen, we're walking in the daylight, not under the cover of darkness, because if we were walking in darkness, we would stumble over everything. But because we are men of light, because we walk in the light, we will not stumble. We know how to avoid the pitfalls and the traps and the tricks that the enemy might set, because we can see clearly because we're walking in the light. Listen, it was not long after he shared that information with them that he said, "Come on, let's go. I'm going to awaken Lazarus out of his sleep." And the disciples said to him, "Well, Master, listen, if he is sleeping, he's doing well." But Jesus didn't mean sleeping in the natural sense. He meant that Lazarus had died. Not that he was eternally separated from God, but he had died a physical death. Now notice, there is no indication that there was information that came to Jesus to let him know that Lazarus had died. He just knew this because he knows all things. And so Jesus, listen, he can know what's happening in your life, what's happening at your address, what's happening at your residence. He already knows what's happening at your house without even being in your house. And so they decide that they're going to follow Jesus back to Judea, to Bethany. He's headed back to the house of Martha, Mary, and Lazarus. And as they're traveling, Thomas says something very unique. He literally uses a neologism. He uses what the hip hop culture has coined, this new phrase. That's what a neologism is. It's a new word or a new phrase that the hip hop culture has coined. And that phrase is ride or die. And ride or die simply means it describes a person that's willing to do things for their partner, for their friend, or for their family, even in the face of danger. And Thomas literally says, let's just go with Jesus. Let's travel with him that we might die with him. Lazarus literally says, let's ride or die with the master. And listen, if you're a follower of Christ, you have to make up in your mind, I'm going to ride or die with the master. I'm going to walk with him even if it places me in harm's way. I'm going to travel with him even if it leads to dangerous and difficult situations, because there's no challenge that following Jesus will present to you or place you in that Jesus cannot handle. So they move out from where they are. They travel to Bethany. They get right outside of the city. And what Jesus does is he assesses the situation. He understands that Lazarus now has been dead for 4 days. He shares with his disciples. He says to them earlier, he says, I'm glad for your sakes that I was not there to the intent that you might believe. Listen, God allows or causes things to happen in our lives that are designed so that the faith of other believers would grow. Had Jesus been there, Lazarus probably would not have died, and the disciples would not have seen what they were about to see, and their faith would not have been developed at the level that it would be. And so he says to them, listen, I'm glad I was not there, so that what's happening to Mary, what's happening to Martha, what's happening to Lazarus would help your faith to grow. Can I share this with you that are listening to me today? Maybe the trouble that you're having, and maybe your trouble, like that of Mary and Martha's, has moved from trouble to tragedy because Lazarus has died. Maybe the trouble and the tragedy that God is allowing you to experience is really designed for other believers to have their faith to grow when they see what you are going through. And so Jesus arrives outside the city of Bethany, and Mary comes running out to him, and she says to him, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. If you had only been here, your presence here would have caused this outcome to be very different than what it is. But remember, Jesus said at the beginning of this story, all of this is happening so that God would be glorified and so that Jesus would be glorified. And in this encounter with Martha, he says these words. I'm reading right out of John 11, verse number 23. He says, Martha says to him, but I know even now that whatever you ask God, he will give it to you. And Jesus says to her, thy brother shall rise again. And Martha said, I know I'll see him again in the resurrection and at the last day. But Jesus says, listen, I am the resurrection. I am the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, though he were physically dead, though he were buried in the grave, yet shall he live. He will still have everlasting life. He will still have eternal life. He will still have spiritual life. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die, shall never be eternally separated from God. And then he asked Martha, do you believe this? And Martha said, yes, I believe. I believe. Listen, she believed the words of Jesus, and I pray to God that you believe the words of Jesus as he tells us, I am the resurrection and the life. After that conversation with Jesus, Martha goes back to the house to call Mary. She tells Mary, listen, the master wants you. The master wants you. And this is interesting because last week when we saw Jesus at Martha's house, it was Martha that was moving around the house, worried and concerned about serving. And it was Mary sitting at the feet of Jesus. But in this particular story, you've got Martha who runs out to meet Jesus while Mary sits at home at the house. And so Martha calls Mary and says, listen, the master wants you. Mary gets up and goes out to where Jesus was, and she does what Mary does. She falls down at his feet, and she repeats the sentiment of her sister Martha. Lord, if you had been here, Lazarus, our brother, would not have died. And she started weeping, and those that were with her started weeping. And Jesus saw her weeping, and Jesus saw the tears and the weeping of the other Jews. And Jesus even got emotional. John says that he groaned in his spirit. John says that he was troubled in his spirit. And John says that he wept while they led him to the grave site of where Lazarus was buried. When Jesus arrived at the gravesite where Lazarus was buried, he says to them, take away the stone, roll away the stone. Mary and Martha, they were concerned because Lazarus had been dead for 4 days. And they said to Jesus, listen, he's probably stinking now in the grave. He's probably stinking. But Jesus said, didn't I tell you that if you believe that you would see the glory of God today? And they rolled away the stone. And Jesus prayed. Jesus prayed. In verses 41 to 42, Jesus prays. It says, then they took away the stone from the place where the dead was laid. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me. And I knew that thou hearest me always, but because of the people which stand by, I said it, that they may believe that thou hast sent me. Here it is again. All of these things happen so that God would be glorified, so that a believer, the faith of believers would grow, and so that unbelievers might begin to believe. Jesus says, Lord, I know you hear me when I pray. You always hear me when I pray. But I'm praying this prayer so that the people that can overhear me talking to you will believe that you sent me, that will believe that I am the promised Messiah, will believe that I am the Savior of the world. And then Jesus, after that prayer, he calls Lazarus by his name. He says, Lazarus, come forth. Lazarus, come forth. And that's exactly what Lazarus did. He got up from the dead. He walked out of that grave. He still had his grave clothes on. And Jesus said, loose him and let him go. Oh, that's great news, my brothers and sisters. When the Lord calls us from our buried situations, when he calls us from our dead situations, when he calls us from our tied up, tied down situations, he will also tell others to untie them, loose them, and let them go. Go. Amen. And do you not know that when those Jews that were standing around that grave site saw what happened, saw him raise Lazarus from the dead, the Bible says that many of them believed on him. Many of them believed he was the Messiah. Many of them believed he was the Savior. Many of them believed that he was the Son of the living God. Many of them believed. Many of them believed. Listen, there are three things that we want to take away from this sermon on today. Number one, God uses our troubles, tragedies, and triumphs to get glory for himself. So whatever it is you're going through, your prayer ought to be, Lord, use it to get glory for yourself. If it's sickness, if it's poverty, if it's pain, if it's trouble, if it's a tragedy, you want to pray to God, God, use it to get glory for yourself. Number two, second takeaway is God uses our troubles, tragedies, and triumphs to grow the faith of other believers. Listen, there are other believers that are watching how you're dealing with what you're dealing with, and it is helping them to trust God more. And thirdly, my brothers and sisters, God uses our troubles, triumphs, and tragedies to inspire non-believers to believe. Because, listen, that's why there's so much power in our testimony. That's why it's so much power in the stories that we tell about how God has brought us through and carried us over and taken care of us and sheltered us and shielded us, because it allows other people to know what he's done for me, he can do it for you. And so our prayer should be, use my life to get glory for yourself. Use my life to grow the faith of others. Use my life to inspire others to believe in you. God bless you today. God uses our trouble, our tragedies, and our triumphs to get glory for himself, to grow the faith of other believers, and then to inspire non-believers to believe. Won't you let the Lord use you? God bless you.
I know you were blessed by that word on this morning. No matter where you are, what you're facing, what you're going through, God can get glory out of it. He can get purpose out of our pain. And it is a great thing to know that if we put our trust in Christ, he's able to cause all things to work together for good. And he's able to bring glory out of our past mistakes and even our present pain. And so I want to encourage you that if you've not invited the Lord Jesus Christ into your heart, if you've not accepted him, I want to encourage you to pray and accept Christ today. In fact, you can call the church number 773-873-4433. Someone is there who wants to pray with you and celebrate the amazing decision you just made. We worship God because he's able to bring glory out of pain. In fact, that's exactly how it is we got saved. We are saved because Jesus went to the cross and he died on the cross for our sins. And in that horrific death, salvation was purchased. And so that's what we celebrate when we come around the Lord's table and celebrate communion. And so if you haven't, I'm going to tell you one more time, because we're going to communion in a little bit. Get your elements, gather your family, because our pastor is going to lead us in communion. Before we go there, I want to remind you to join us on Wednesday night at 7 p.m. We have our prayer meeting and conference call, and we would love to connect with you on Zoom. You'll see that information on your screen. Make sure you join us on Wednesday night, and then stay tuned today at 9 o'clock. Our Sunday school will air on Facebook, on YouTube, and on our website. We want you to get that lesson and be blessed by that. And then at 10 a.m., Antioch Live will stream from the sanctuary of the Antioch Missionary Baptist Church on Facebook only. Now that you've got your elements, let's go around the Lord's table as we're led in communion by our lead pastor, the Reverend Dr. Gerald M. Duke.
Thank you so much, Digital Pastor Carter, and to my Antioch family and all of our friends. What a blessing it is for us to be able to be at the communion table one more time. I pray that you have assembled your elements and that you have your mind and heart focused on Jesus Christ, focused on the great expression of God's love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Amen. Oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me. Scripture declares that as they were eating, Jesus took bread and he blessed it and broke it and gave it to his disciples. Of the bread, he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Then he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he commanded them to drink. Of the cup, he said, "This is the blood of the new covenant, shed for the remission of sin." Let us now bow and ask God's blessing upon this bread and this wine. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you today to say thank you for such an awesome expression of love. You are love. Your word says God is love. And you so loved the world that you gave your only begotten Son, that those of us that would believe in him would not perish but have everlasting life. Father, we pray right now in the name of Jesus that you would inspect our hearts, look into our lives, God. We admit that we've not done everything that your word says do. We've been disobedient. We've been lax. God, we have sinned. But your word says that if we confess our sins, that you're faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And so, Father, right now we receive that cleansing that comes from your word, that cleansing that comes from the blood of Jesus. We thank you for the cleansing. Now, Father, we pray that you would bless this bread and this wine, that you would consecrate our minds as we partake of it on today. God, bless it that we might reflect and remember the cross of Calvary and the substitutionary sufficient death that he died on Calvary, and how we thank you for offering up your Son as a sacrifice for our sins. We pray these favors, God, in Jesus' name, amen. With our minds at Calvary, Jesus says, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Take, eat." Then he says, "This is the blood of the new covenant, shed for the remission of sin. Drink ye all of it." Amen. Bible says that after the supper, they sang a hymn and went out to the Mount of Olives. Amen. We conclude these services on today, and I pronounce God's best blessings upon each one of you, that he would use your life, your tragedies, troubles, and triumphs to get glory for himself, to cause the faith of other believers to grow, and to cause unbelievers to believe. God bless you.
Thank you for joining Antioch Live. We appreciate our faithful listeners and viewers for your support for 60 years. Tell your family, tell your friends. Join us every Sunday at 8 o'clock a.m. And don't forget our live stream service at 10 o'clock a.m. Until next time, may God bless all of you real, real good.